This year, we begin our celebration of the 200th anniversary of the United States Constitution. Today on Public Affairs Roundtable, we're going to talk about this document, what it is, what it means, has it worked for 200 years, and what do Americans know or think about it? Our panelists today are Jim Boardman, who is an attorney with the Muncie law firm DeFer Varan Hanley Radcliffe & Reed, Louis Engelhardt, professor emeritus of journalism at Ball State University, and John Rouse, producer of Public Affairs Roundtable and a member of the political science faculty at Ball State. John, what's so remarkable about this document that now we celebrate that it was a new form of government, but is it so outstanding, is it so unique, so different that we need to have 2 years of celebrations about it?
Don't know if I can answer that particular question, but let me say that in terms of answering part of the question, the document has existed now for 200 years, and it is, I believe, the oldest one in existence. The Swiss document came shortly thereafter. I think the importance of the American Constitution, and of course this goes back to the year 1787, is that for the first time in history, in terms of thinking about democracy, government either tended towards a strong, consolidated kind of government, king and a dictator, or towards a loosely confederated system. In other words, one that didn't work very well. So on one hand, in the history of mankind prior to 1787, there was a focus upon centralization of power and dictatorship. On the other hand, there was fragmentation and things didn't work. So the American system is a combination of centralizing power in the national government and decentralizing power in state and local governments, or a combination of the two. So I think in terms of its historical emphasis, the focus, of course, is upon a democracy. Keep in mind that we do not have a democracy. Now, this is not a democracy in this country. This is a republic. We have a democratic kind of government, but we have a republican form of government. So it's important to keep those things in mind. Very quickly, we'd also say that the whole economic picture has changed drastically in the last 200 years, and the Constitution has been able to survive much new technology and much new development as far as economics are concerned.
We could go back quite a bit on the idea of a bicentennial. All of us noticed there was a bicentennial for the Declaration of Independence, and it was a lot of fun because you could have a lot of excitement, fireworks, and that sort of thing. It. The Constitution, however, is a stuffier kind of document, and how do you celebrate it? Actually, their question has been raised some time. Several years ago, I was in a position to work a little bit with the subcommittee on the Constitution of the Senate Judiciary Committee to try to encourage them to make the bicentennial stretch through the adoption of the Bill of Rights. And they finally have done that. But the difficulty is, when you say 200 years, what are you talking about? They have decided that I think September 17 is Constitution Day. That's the day they sent the proposed document to the Continental Congress to get it ratified. But actually, it was a year and a half later before it was ratified and went into effect. You could pick almost any day and say that would be a good day, but actually the celebration will go from this year through 1991, December 15, when the Bill of Rights was ratified.
Because it took that long to approve the Constitution. I think one of the focuses that we find this year, and in answer to Larry's question, in terms of 200 years, why celebrate now, is that there is a perceived lack of knowledge, even ignorance, by the American people about the Constitution. So I think that's also part of the focus.
It takes 6 or 7 years for people to understand and pay enough attention to various programs and activities to learn enough about it to comprehend it. Actually, John, I think the way I like to think about it is that the body of the Constitution established a republican form of government, distinctly different from any other kind of government that had ever existed. But the Bill of Rights, which came along later, established a method of government, a democratic government. So we have a democratic republic, and it's real appropriate, I believe, for one of our major political parties to be called the Republican Party and another one a Democratic Party, because they perpetuate the philosophy and nature of our government traditionally through those names.
Tim is a recent student and certainly as a lawyer working with constitutional law, directly or indirectly. Do you find it surprising that there is a widespread unfamiliarity with what the Constitution says or what it means?
No. In a lot of ways, it really takes us 6 or 7 years to learn to understand the Constitution and become familiar with it. The interesting thing about the Constitution as opposed to the Declaration of Independence is it's not a stagnant document. It's not the same thing today as it was in 1787. And if it was, it probably wouldn't exist today. It's something that, as John Marshall once said, it's something we're expounding. It's something we're developing. And the Constitution changes and shifts as the mood of the country shifts and opens up so it is able to handle new situations. And that's how it's been able to develop over 200 years. And it will change. And a lot of people really may not become familiar with the Constitution that they learned in grade school as it's changed over the years.
So some of the source of problems seems to be with the Bill of Rights itself. Is a lot of people, while enjoying the rights that are guaranteed by the Constitution, don't really seem to understand it, and if questioned, don't seem to agree with some of the principles expounded there.
That's true. Of course, the Constitution has taken 184 years to be created, if you consider the last amendment, which was passed in 1971. The job is not yet done. There will be more amendments. So it is a living Constitution, even though it is a written one. Now, the Bill of Rights was the completion of the initial Constitution, because without that, there never would have been a Constitution. It would have been rejected by the states. So the Congress made good on promises to create a Bill of Rights. Most of the rhetoric, eloquently extolling the strength of our Constitution, really is based on what's found in the Bill of Rights instead of the body of the Constitution. That's why you have to look at both of those as a total document to understand where we are. And some people are appalled to find about how powerful and extensive the rights guaranteed in the Bill of Rights really are. They cannot be taken away from anyone by government. And there they are, strong and violent.
If I could ask both you and Jim this question, understanding the fact that the Constitution promotes a federal system, let me ask each of you, is federalism dead as it was proposed 200 years ago? Jim?
No, certainly not. I think that over the past 200 years, more power has probably shifted towards the federal government, the central government, and away from the states in a certain way. Yet, certainly, rights are retained by individuals, and rights have been added to individuals, such as the 14th Amendment, which apply due process, equal protection to the states. So therefore, the states still have certain powers, but the federal government has more, but yet individuals over the last 100 years, I think, have been given more rights and liberties.
Well, Jim, this decision of the Supreme Court that we read Monday about upholding property rights through government zoning changes, wasn't that based on the due process in the 14th Amendment that the court came out with? They said you can't rezone if it destroys the value of property. You have to pay the property owner for it.
That would have been, that's a good area to start. Due process would be involved in a situation where you are taking property away or devaluing the property of individuals. And it is a strong step for individuals. I think that it says the government cannot come in and lower your value without paying you for it. Where in the past, your property isn't condemned or really taken away, and they might not have protected you as strongly for just a loss in value.
President Reagan introduced what he called a new federalism. It was his proposal, of course, to transfer some of the power of a strong federal government back to the states is that an indication, as John says, that federalism as we knew it from the Federalists who helped develop the Constitution, is that federalism so much different from what Ronald Reagan has in mind?
Yes, I think it's quite different. Alexander Hamilton and the people who believed in a strong central government carried the day in the Constitutional Convention. You want to remember there were 73 people who were supposed to be delegates to that convention. Only 55 of them ever showed up. 16 of them refused to sign the thing or got so miffed that they left before the thing was over. So there are only 39 that ever signed the Constitution. But these 39 represented people who believed in a strong central government. And that's what we got. Now, the thing that we have had since then is all kinds of efforts to act as if we don't have a strong central government. And if it's politically desirable to condemn Washington, D.C. as a foreign power, we dress it up with nice terms like new federalism and that sort of thing. But the basic structure of this country is that we do have a strong central government, and we have satellite governments with far less power and significance. That's the way it works.
If I could slightly disagree with Lou, I'd say that federalism is pretty much alive, at least on these three bases. First of all, you have a decentralization, a devolving of power to the states. For example, if you pass programs on food stamps and, say, highways, the food stamp program, the guidelines are written by the national government, the national Congress. But the nuance of implementation is implemented by your local welfare office, which is a function of the state. If you look at the recent controversy in terms of highway speed limits, the national government has been one to set the speed limit previously at 55, now at 65. But who implements the nuance of how fast we go but the state patrol? So, in terms of the first point, federalism is pretty much alive as the functions of the federal government have been delegated to the state governments for implementation. A second point I would make in terms of federalism is that if you look at our party system, there's nothing in our Constitution or any place else that says what should be prescribed in terms of the parties at the local level. They can be bigots, they can have any kind of opinions they want to have if they can get nominated and selected by their parties. And that's completely delegated at the local level. There's no control by the national government over who's going to be the chair of the Republican or Democratic county parties here in Indiana in the counties. A third area is a focus upon social values. The social values of every state are different. For example, years ago, in Catholic-focused Massachusetts, you couldn't buy condoms. In Baptist-focused South Carolina, you couldn't get a drink of beer. So the social values then of every state are different. So in that sense, federalism is very much alive in this country.
Could you get condoms there even though you couldn't get beer?
Well, I have to admit, Lou, that I am no expert on either condoms or beer. But I think my point is that the social values of particular states are different.
Well, the thing that you failed to mention in your three points was that the Congress decided whether the states could set speed limits. That was federal action.
Well, that's my whole point. I'm saying it is the state patrol that implements the decision in the final analysis. Except, they're the ones who decide how fast we go.
Except, Jim, don't we have the Supreme Court that says, hey, you've gone too far, state, or hey, you've gone too far, federal government? Here's the way it has to work, and if we measured it, it's with what constitutional law permits.
Certainly. The Supreme Court will decide which one has passed over a certain boundary.
But the court may propose, but the people will dispose. And then so despite what the court does and says, the American people have to decide if they're going to be racist or not racist, or be fair-minded, or be productive, or whatever they're going to choose to be.
And that is reflected in not only how state governments run, but they do elect congressmen, they do elect the president, who appoints Supreme Court justices, who are ratified or confirmed by the Senate, elected senators.
The First Amendment protects your right to opinion and expression of opinion. However, it does not protect your right to action. That's where you might end up in jail if you try to convert your beliefs into action that is violent or disruptive or for which the state has a compelling interest to intervene. So it's not as wide open, maybe, as John, you've indicated, or Larry, you've indicated. We have to behave ourselves.
The focus of the Constitution and its strength is that somehow it strikes a balance between order and liberty. And that's a very delicate kind of balance as the country has evolved.
Well, that balance is expressed in the Bill of Rights. You don't have a right to everything. You have a limited number of rights, maybe a total of about 80 rights that are listed in the Constitution. You cannot declare that other things you like to do or want to do are rights. They're not. They're privileges or actions.
Sometimes we talk about auxiliary rights. Lou, do you buy that? I mean, like the right for the public to know. There is no right to know in the Constitution, but the court did not read that out of the First Amendment.
The court has ruled there is no such thing as a right to know.
Exactly. But doesn't the media make a big deal of it?
Yeah, that's self-serving, isn't it?
Well, it certainly is. Which is a point I wanted to bring up. How does a journalist justify the fact that that we propose and that we fight for public access laws, open meetings, open records, Freedom of Information Act, yet this constitutional document, which we're talking about, was put together in secret in a private meeting over the objections of Thomas Jefferson, who was in Paris rather than Philadelphia, could not argue his point, but it was put together in a secret meeting.
Well, except it wasn't all that secret, even though they said they were going to do it. Old Ben Franklin would go to the tavern at night and get liquored up and tattle on whoever would listen to him what they had done. And when they printed the Constitution in August, the printer made 200 copies available to all comers. I think that one of the lessons that we have learned, and we learn it over and over again, is that there's no way that anyone can keep anything secret if somebody wants to dig and find out about it. It's interesting to note that the Constitution provides the freedom to publish whatever people want to publish. It does not provide a right to gather news or information or a right to know things. The framers based their hopes on a vigorous public debate fueled by a vigorous press that might not have any ethics, by the way.
But Lou, the point I think should be made is that the First Amendment was not in existence prior to the Constitution.
Oh, well, in other words, you're ruling that out as not being important.
So I'm saying that it was not under the constitutional framework when the document was being...
The body of the Constitution, but I contend that without the Bill of Rights, we do not have a Constitution.
Well, absolutely, but my point is that when the framers met in 1787, there was no such thing as the First Amendment.
No, but they all believed in freedom of the press. They simply said that that was a great natural right, that the government didn't have any business messing with, so it wasn't necessary to put it in the Constitution. That was a mistake, and it almost destroyed the Constitution.
Wasn't that part of the various states' constitutions?
States had protection for freedom of the press.
And it was just a natural adoption of that right into the Constitution, wasn't it? There wasn't a lot of discussion in that matter.
Well, there was tremendous discussion after the Constitution was presented.
The thing I'd like to do is to bring this conversation 200 years hence and ask Jim... Jim, with the focus upon the Iran scandal and people in the country ask the question, what are the rights of Congress as far as making foreign policy, and how does this Iran scandal kind of thing or controversy fit into the constitutional perspective?
When the Constitution was written and drafted 200 years ago, there certainly wasn't, in the framers' mind, the type of vast transportation and power to handle foreign matters and the rapidity with which a country can strike at your country today. And they gave the Congress the power to declare a war, but they gave the president the power to repel attack. And at that time, attack would certainly take months from a foreign government to sail across the sea, whereas now it takes maybe 7 minutes. And in the Iran affair, and with this Boland Amendment, what they're questioning is how much Congress is able to tell the president, you cannot, in your capacity as executive in foreign policy, confer with other governments or other people, private sources, to expend money on behalf of the Contras in Nicaragua. Congress has the power to fund and give the president and the executive the money to go ahead and act. What they did in the Boland Amendment was they said you cannot give the Nicaraguan Contras money. You cannot. We're not going to allocate funds to go to these people for the next couple of years. And during that time, the president went ahead and through Oliver North and through former General Secord, they generated funds and funneled them to the Contras. Does the Boland Amendment apply to the executive? The Constitution generally gives foreign power and policy to the president, and that is what his argument is today. The Boland Amendment does not apply to me, because if it does apply to me, now Congress has overstepped its bounds, and they're acting unconstitutionally, and then you've got a breach of the separation of powers that was the main reason for establishing an executive and a Congress.
You should point out, I think, Jim, that the Boland Amendment is an amendment to a congressional law, statutory law, not a constitutional amendment. And really, a lot of the things like freedom of information are statutory things. If they do not conflict with the Constitution, they can apply and hold and be changed quickly and easily.
So from that point of view, it'd be difficult to even think about impeaching Reagan, because it'd have to be a violation, not of a congressional statute, but the basic document, the Constitution?
No, he could be impeached for high crimes, which could be...
almost anything.
The problem with this situation, with the Iran-Contra scandal ever going to the point of impeachment, is there is a legitimate question as to whether the Boland Amendment to this congressional act is a usurpation of the power of the president given by the Constitution. And the general philosophy of the judiciary in interpreting the statute is interpret it so that it will fit into the Constitution. And therefore, you would have to try and narrow the focus of that act so as it does not breach upon the executive power under the Constitution.
Okay, if I can follow you or take you into another area, the Persian Gulf is also a potential constitutional problem coming up as well. Do these kinds of dynamics transfer to that particular issue?
In that Persian Gulf area, you're going to apply, or Congress will attempt to apply the War Powers Act, a resolution requiring the president to go ahead and ask Congress for the right to be in the Persian Gulf for an extended period of time. And that act also has come under constitutional scrutiny due to a legislative veto, which has been ruled as unconstitutional.
You know, when they were framing the Constitution, they were having similar problems with Tripoli, and the Navy had to go over and get after them. But there was a declared war, and Congress is fully informed about those matters. The basis of Congress's objection to what's been going on is that they have not been informed as fully as they should be under the rules of the game. But this, four of us can't decide this. If it's a judicial issue, if it's a legal issue, that has to be handled by the Supreme Court. That's the agency that decides such things, not us.
The Supreme Court isn't likely, at least in my estimation, to deal in the Iran-Contra affair, though, simply because the Supreme Court has often said it's foreign policy. This is politics. This isn't our area. We stay out of this. That's for you to hatch out with the Congress, and the Congress, you to hatch out with the executive. And I don't think that they will ever, even if asked, that they would have a definitive ruling or attempt to rule on
it.
No, they would not.
I think a couple of things we could focus on is that we're talking about legal issues, and whether the president has the legal right to do what he did with the Contra issue. The more important issue is, does the policy make sense, and does he have the support of the American people? Because it's very difficult to have any kind of program if the American people do not believe in the believability of the program. So I think the first thing we're looking at from the constitutional point of view is the legal aspect. But the political aspect is, does a particular program have the support of the American people?
bottom line, does the Constitution work, Lou? Is it working?
Oh, yeah, I think it works very well. That's why a number of people who are caught up in difficulties, political and otherwise, are so distraught when they find out that the constitutional law does apply and it does work, and it works no matter what the makeup of the Supreme Court is. Those people who get appointed justices stop thinking politically and start reading the law. Read the Constitution. They say, oh my, is that in there? And they judge accordingly. That's why they don't end up like people speculate they will be.
That's why the press shouldn't be so concerned about Rehnquist and Scalia being on the Supreme Court.
Yeah, I think so.
Media bashes.
I think so. As a matter of fact, I think everybody ought to read the Constitution. Larry, I want to embarrass you. Here's a copy of the Constitution. I'm not going to ask you whether you read it or not, but this is put out by the Bicentennial Commission. If you buy enough of them, they're only 15 cents. Why don't you go down to your newspaper and say, why don't we make a copy of this available to every high school student in Delaware County, and we can get the high school newspapers to distribute it for us.
I think that's an excellent idea, Lou. I will take this as a complimentary copy and put it away and certainly write 15 cents off somehow. And I do thank you for that contribution and that idea, and I will propose to those people who make this decision. Jim, is the Constitution working quickly?
Wonderfully. Because of its ability to be expounded and changed, public opinion and the American people have been able to develop what they want the Constitution to be.
It works well sometimes. It does not work well other times. The problem now is that it's difficult to respond to many, many, many crises around the world as long as the president doesn't have the power to do so.
Without 200 years of foresight, those things happen. Thanks to our panelists, Lou Englehart, Jim Borgman, and John Rouse for the commentary today. I'm Larry Law. Thank you for joining us.
If you have comments regarding this program, please address them to John Rouse, Box 149, Muncie, Indiana, 47305. The producer for Public Affairs Roundtable is John Rouse. Associate producers are Bill Mosier and Mike Seaborg. This program is a production of University Media Services, the Department of Political Science, and radio and television stations on the campus of Ball State University in Muncie, Indiana.